Come along and ride this train. Come along and ride this train. Across the mountains, prairies, reservations, rivers, levees, plains. Come along and ride this train.
Tonight we'd like to tell you the story of another kind of man.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash!
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
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 Hi, I'm John Cash.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on.
Johnny Cash's America was not red, white, or blue, but black. And that blackness contained multitudes.
He appealed to everybody. He went across all the lines. Liberal, conservative, Democratic, Republican, independent.
I look at the footage of him performing live in prison and seeing how the inmates respected him and didn't want to kill him or want to stab him. That shows that his music is made for all walks of life, and for him to even go do a show for them showed love, it showed compassion.
I hang my head and cry.
He encouraged people who had never been encouraged by anyone else to do anything besides sit down and shut up.
He had a huge connection to middle America, God-fearing people connected to the earth, who looked to him for leadership.
Johnny Cash was more like a religious figure to me, always has been.
He had a passion and a courage that was so attractive to everybody.
You could almost project onto that big black frame whatever you wanted to. And maybe that's why so many different kind of people were comfortable with Johnny Cash.
Cash navigated some of the most contentious issues of our times without losing his audience. How did events shape Cash? And what did he reflect back onto the country? How can one speak his mind without losing his voice?
Come along and ride this train. Come along and ride this train. Across the mountains, prairies, reservations, rivers, levees, plains. Come along and ride this train.
We had a small farm. My father was a cotton farmer, plowed with mules. Walked behind the mules with the plow. And I did that as well.
Come along and ride this train.
It was a family thing. Everybody in the family worked in the field.
I got cotton in the bottom land. It's up and growing, and I got a good stand. My good wife and them kids of mine are gonna get new shoes come picking time. Get new shoes come picking time.
I lived in northeast Arkansas in the Black Delta land along Mississippi County, Arkansas, in the cotton country.
Johnny had it hard. He had a hard life, like everybody that was born back in the 30s. And back in those days, life was tough. We didn't have no hamburgers and all that good stuff like they have nowadays, pizza, you know.
But I'll set up late come picking time. Set up late come picking time. Well, last Sunday morning when they...
I come up the hard way, too. When you do have something, it don't take you long to know that, my goodness, I sure didn't have this when I started. You know, I better watch it and I better save.
The Lord will wait till picking time. Lord will wait till picking time.
Y'all, here's the city right here. You want to ask anybody anything? It's on down this road.
This is it, where I grew up.
right here in this little house.
The tree on the left side is the tree we all climbed.
You all four shared a bedroom?
We had two beds in there. There were seven of us, baby.
Oh, wow.
And on the other side is the was the dining room.
Seven, eight, nine people lived in that house?
At one time, they did. Was glad to have it. Was glad and thankful to have it.
Johnny Cash was only half joking when he said he was raised under socialism. Diaz, Arkansas started as colonization project number one, a New Deal development that provided small plots of land to the poorest of families.
So many people moved in here, they couldn't take it. They couldn't work that hard, so they moved out. The tough ones stayed, and we were tough. We stayed.
In 1937, the Mississippi River went over the bank and broke the levees, flooded the cotton land along northeast Arkansas. My dad said he was going to stay with the house just as long as he could. Well, little by little, he watched the water rising on the front steps, and he decided that when it had risen 5 feet high, he was going to have to leave. Well, he did leave, and 20 years later, I wrote this song called 5 Feet High and Rising. How high is the water, Mama? 2 feet high and rising. How high is the water, Papa? She said it's 2 feet high and rising.
It was one thing that he was extremely proud of, his roots, where he started. He knew exactly who he was and where he came from.
He was definitely connected to land, and he was very knowledgeable about plant life and trees, and he could always tell if it was going to rain or not going to rain, and I think that's where a lot of his spirituality came from, was in nature.
Yeah, my father never forgot his roots. He never forgot where he came from. And then the writing, then the music, it would become therapy to him. It brought him back home.
How high is the water, Mama? 4 feet high and rising.
I think the thing that struck me about early Johnny, and really even till the end, was that it sounded like where I was from. It sounded like the country that I was used to. It sounded like the churches I was in, just steeped in Americana.
You get in trouble when you stop sounding like where you grew up. I think maybe Johnny Cash's genius was that he always sounded like where he grew up. He never lost that. He was bona fide.
How high is the water, Papa? She said it's 5 feet high and rising. Well, the rails are washed out north of town. We gotta head for higher ground. Can't come back till the water goes down. 5 feet high and rising. Well, it's 5 feet high and rising.
There's some sweet memories and some sad memories too, but it was a good life, and the redeeming factor of it all was the radio.
When we would come in from the cotton fields at noon, we'd lay on Mama's linoleum floor in the living room to cool off. I remember Jack saying, I'm going to be a preacher. I'm going to preach the Word of God and tell people about Jesus. And Johnny said, well, you know what? Listen to that Carter family on the radio. One day you're going to hear me on the radio. I'm going to sing.
At about 12 or 13, I told my dad, I said, Johnny Cash, J.R. Cash, is going someplace someday. He said, yeah, your dad burned right to the cotton fields.
That's where he is, right behind that.
John lost his brother Jack in a workshop accident at the high school. He was sort of leaned over, and the table saw when it just cut him wide open.
At that time, Daddy didn't know the Lord, and Jack looked up at Daddy and said, Daddy, will you meet me in heaven? And Daddy said, yes, Jack, I will. And he got on his knees beside Jack's bed and gave his heart to the Lord. And on Jack's tombstone, it says, will you meet me in heaven? It's even hard. It's hard today to think about that and realize that he was about to go to heaven. Father God, we thank you for another opportunity to remember our family that's already with you, Father. We praise you for knowing that. We praise you for this time of just being together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will the circle be unbroken? By and by, Lord, by and by, there's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
Truths about the human experience seems to be that suffering binds people together. And the greatest learning often comes from the deepest pain. He'd been through a lot of pain.
His older brother, who is his hero, is dead. What does that say about Cash's own future? There are no guarantees. In addition, his father blames him for his death, says that maybe it should have been you, Johnny, instead of Jack, who died.
The silver lining in that terribly dark cloud was Cash grew up. He did assume this sense of gravity, and however wrongly or rightly he assumed any guilt for his brother's death, it was around that time that he began playing the guitar more seriously and writing poetry.
I lived on that farm until I went to the Air Force. I knew that when I left there at the age of 18, I wouldn't be back.
Dice had nothing to offer for kids except farming. We wasn't going to farm. We were going to do something else.
You know, there's nothing that stirs my imagination like the sound of a steam locomotive. That lonesome whistle cutting through the night, and that column of black smoke and steam throwing shadows across the land. When I was a boy, the trains ran by my house, and they carried with them a promise that somewhere down the track, anything would be possible.
Now I taught the weeping willow how to cry, and I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky. And the tears that I cried for that woman are gonna flood you, big river, and I'm gonna sit right here until I die.
In the 1950s, new sounds were expressing new ideas, and Johnny Cash sought his place in that big river of song.
I'm sure as soon as Johnny Cash was old enough to know where he was and where Memphis was, that's where he was headed. The thing about Memphis that you have to understand first is that it was the Mecca, you know? It was the goal. If you can turn this corner, there is a new kind of freedom.
Memphis was really a mixture of a lot of different kinds of people and cultures, most of them poor. I found
her trail in Memphis. Sun Records in Memphis attracted the action. There, Sam Phillips recorded Black singing the blues, and then white singers arrived wanting to do the same.
Sam was looking for something different. He knew he couldn't compete with Nashville music and New York music and all that stuff. He knew he had to do something radically different. And that brings you Johnny Cash and Elvis Presley, Carl Perkins, me, you know.
These voices needed to be heard, particularly by the young, and of course there were a lot of young, to listen to those voices.
Rock and roll was coming, which was a little bit naughty given the culture of the times. Memphis was right at the center of things, and Johnny Cash was right at the center of that at Sun Records.
She loves you, Big River, more than me.
Amy Levere, and I'm a musician. I moved to Memphis in 99, and I'm a tour guide at Sun Studio. Memphis, in general, just seems to encourage artists to be authentic and do something that's their own. You're not playing for anything other than the art and the audience in Memphis, you know, for better or worse. Johnny Cash was very different than the other Sun artists. He didn't look like the other artists. He surely didn't sound anything like them.
John Cash was never your normal country star. I mean, from the minute he walked into Sun.
Cash had been working as the world's worst salesman while playing music in his free time with two mechanics he had met.
We started working on these instruments, and Luther couldn't play the guitar. I couldn't play bass, and John was the only one that knew what he was doing, playing the rhythm guitar, and he wasn't the greatest in the world.
The fellas that are backing you up on the show today, didn't they start in the business with you?
Yes, they did. Two of them did. We added one later. On bass, Marshall Grant started with us. Later, we added W.S. Holland. He joined the group. Like the guitar, Luther Perkins has always been with us.
Now we have the voice of Johnny Cash, and a career is off and running.
Luther Perkins only played three strings of the guitar, and only two at a time.
Boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom, chicka,
boom, chicka, boom, chicka, boom, chicka.
Ticka tack, ticka tack, ticka tack, ticka tack.
Don't, don't. You know, that was great. Nobody ever done it.
Everybody knows where you go when the sun goes down. I think you only live to see the light.
I mean, that basic thing that they did was so minimalistic that there was all this space for this big, you know, masculine voice.
You're gonna cry, cry, cry.
Our inability had more to do with our success than our ability did. And I'm not ashamed of that.
You're left on your own, you're gonna cry, cry, cry.
He focused on what it was that he was good at, and he didn't concern himself so much with the fact that he wasn't going to feel comfortable out there shaking his hips.
Elvis had moved from Sun to a major label, and Cash took note.
I lose my pants, I left charge extra to get in here next Saturday night.
Cash found himself cast as his replacement, but refused to play along.
This was not your pretty boy, sex symbol, hoppin' dancing, rock and roll kid. He had this very deep, dark depth about his persona.
Well, he hated being categorized. He wanted to explore all the territory, and he saw himself as being kind of without boundaries, that he could go anywhere he wanted to.
I hear the train a-coming. It's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on.
He touched people, man. I mean, them records touch people. You got people who really live those stories, who live that. I shot a man dead and watched him die, blood, all this stuff. They really feel that, you know what I'm saying? Like, how could he say that? But at the same time, it really exists.
Always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
The speed at which Johnny Cash taught himself to be Johnny Cash is pretty astounding. The level of musicianship that he started out from, and the songwriting. The songwriting is astounding.
As Johnny Cash grew artistically, he had found his voice, but he knew that musically and artistically that he had a lot more to offer.
He was the type of person that had to have his freedom. He had to do what he wanted to do. He could not be forced into a situation. He couldn't stand closed-in areas.
Well, if they freed me from this prison, if that railroad train was mine, I bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line.
So Cash leaves Sun Records, sets out to the West, and he signs with Columbia. He finds that, in fact, seeking his freedom pays off in a grand way.
Oh, my blues away. I'd sing more about more of this land, but all God's children ain't free. I'd open up every door I can, 'cause all God's children ain't free.
As the cultural chasms in America deepened and communities were torn apart, musicians did not turn away from the divide.
Civil rights movement was given voice in a lot of American folk music. Specific stories that were told in the course of a song, injustices that were exposed. And I think John had a real understanding of the importance of that kind of music.
I don't think Dad heard things like country, folk, rock. I think he was totally oblivious to that. He just did what was in his heart.
My father had a way of reaching out and singing songs for everyone in need and becoming the spokesperson, if need be, for those who couldn't speak.
From a sharecropper shack or penitentiary, all God's children ain't free.
Cash runs through, what, six, five decades of music? I mean, how much is there? But I think the closest and most significant parallel is between him and Dylan.
Johnny Cash was, at that time, if not now, maybe if, he was the epitome of country music. He was the living ultimate end. And also, you know, I loved all of his gospel songs, too. And meeting him was, at that point, you know, high thrill of a lifetime.
I don't sing a song with you, one of those songs you wrote. One of those countless billions and billions of country folk protest songs, Johnny.
That's what you
It's nice to be here, man, with a real protest for a change.
That's what you got against me. I didn't write the song, did I? I did it because nobody else would.
Wait till you get to Dublin.
They were, I know no one else could enter into their world. They were definitely on each other's wavelengths.
John was intrigued by Dylan, and vice versa. They loved one another.
His songs meant a lot to me, that line, I met her accidentally in St. Paul, Minnesota. I mean, that would just give me the chills every time I heard that.
I met her accidentally in St. Paul, Minnesota, and it tore me up every time I heard her drawl, southern drawl. Then I heard
a song like Big River sounds more like a Dylan song than a Hank Williams song.
We see each other time to time here and there and get together and, you know, pound songs out. A lot of it just went by in a blur.
Take one, Johnny Cash, Bob Dylan, 1,000 miles behind. Take one.
They both had limited abilities to do what they were going to do, but they did it so well when they did find their notch that it sort of blended with one another.
Down the street the dogs are barking and the day is getting dark. When the night begins to fall, then a dog will lose their bark.
The country music community, believe me, did not embrace Bob Dylan. And Cash did as soon as, you know, there was an opportunity.
It brought in a whole audience and gave it a legitimacy to country music that it hadn't had before outside of country music fans.
From the crossroads of my doorstep, my eyes, they begin to fade.
It translated to a large audience that this was an art form rather than shit-kicking music.
Each writer gave the other the freedom to play with words. Dylan's political songs would influence Cash's topical writing throughout his career.
Honestly, he would listen to someone with his heart and not be thrown off by even the most controversial label if he felt that what he was getting was the truth. Native American rights, for example, there were times when some of the causes that came to symbolize the struggle for freedom and respect for Native Americans were stigmatized.
My name is Will Peters, that's my English name.
My Lakota name is Tachankulutawonspewichakya, which means the teacher of the Red Way. We are here today at the site of the Wounded Knee Massacre. We won't go any further out of respect for those who were needlessly slaughtered here. Johnny Cash came here back in 1968. He learned of a people that was buried and nobody cried, nobody said a prayer, nobody sang a song. So perhaps in his good soul, he said, I'll sing the songs.
Bigfoot was an Indian chief of a peaceful Indian band, a band of Minneconju Sioux from South Dakota land.
Well, this old medicine man, when he found out I was going to Wounded Knee the next day, he said, I had a vision that you would write a song called Bigfoot about the Wounded Knee tragedy. Such a mystical air hung over the place that I just had to write.
Bigfoot, Bigfoot, rise up from your bed. Many Conju babies cry while their mothers lying dead.
Cash had grown up idolizing cowboys, but by the 1960s, his interest had turned to Indians. He explored their history on the album Bitter Tears. When country DJs ignored his effort, Cash accused the music industry of wallowing in meaninglessness.
It was all hunted down up this canyon.
He's part Indian, Johnny Cash was.
He and his family, the Cash side, were almost 100% Scottish.
There is some Indian blood in this. I believe it's Cherokee.
My dad believed that he was Native American, and he was. And later in life, it became evident in studying that he didn't have any Native American blood in him.
You know, I guess I wanted to be part Indian so bad I said I was.
I got very little Indian blood in me myself, except in my heart. I got 100% for you tonight.
Well, I think he was trying to remind everybody about the Indians, because this was their land. We took it away from them.
He saw that as analogous to the civil rights movement and the plight of the blacks at that time.
Big Chief Bigfoot, your Minneconju band, is mourned and remembered here in South Dakota land. A young cowboy named Billy Joe grew restless on the farm. A boy filled with wanderlust who really meant no harm. He changed his clothes and shined his boots and combed his dark hair down. But his mother cried as he walked out, "Don't take your guns to town, son. Leave your guns at home, Bill. Don't take your guns to town."
Christopherson wrote a song about me, and in that song was a line that says, "He's a walking contradiction, partly truth and partly fiction."
My dad's, he had a light side and a dark side, and both were plainly evident, and he didn't try to cover either. They were both very real, and both glaringly true.
Don't take your guns to town, son. Leave your guns at home, Bill. Don't take your guns to town.
Johnny Cash was always an outsider. His dark side loomed large, and trouble was never far. He understood life on the margins.
He had an ability to empathize with those who were shunned and outcast and had committed terrible offenses, but maintained a human dignity, and in spite of their guilt.
I just think his teaching was through example and through his personal endeavors that he had in life, because I could never see him saying, "Don't do drugs and don't do this and don't do that," but the way, "Don't bring your guns to town," that's telling you, hypothetically, if you bring your guns to town, you're gonna get in a shootout and you're gonna get killed. Your mom told you, don't bring your guns to town.
Don't take your guns to town, son. Leave your guns at home, Bill. Don't take your guns to town.
Fame was pretty hard to handle, actually. The temptations were women, girls, which I loved, and then amphetamines.
It was just entirely different. The whole entire country was on speed. Nashville, Tennessee would never have occurred had you taken the methamphetamine market away. I hate to tell you that, folks, but you can check it out. It came in little pills.
The doctors got these nice pills that give us energy and keep us awake. So I started taking those, and I liked them so much I got addicted to them. I was taking the pills for a while, and then the pills started taking me.
You can take all of the good things that you can possibly think of, and you want to talk about those things. Turn that 180 degrees, and there is this other guy.
They called him on stage one night, and they called him on four times. So I went in his dressing room, and he had these pills in a bottle, and them daggone pills went everywhere. He said, would you please pick up my aspirins?
Mama would say, he's going to be all right. He's going to be all right because we're going to pray for him. And God will take care of him because God has his hand on him.
While on pills, Cass survived overdoses, car crashes, and a forest fire he'd started. The Grand Ole Opry banned him even before he was busted at the Mexican border with over 1,000 pills. Though he never did hard time, these brushes with the law had an unintended consequence.
And I think it was one of the things that made him so attractive to young and old people alike was the wild thing, the unpredictable part of him.
Johnny Cash was a chameleon, man. He could change himself. And, you know, here's a guy that could get busted for drugs, and he never lost his fans. His fans always forgave him for everything.
He was an unbelievable kind of archetype that we could all look at and relate to and say, that's me, that's the struggle that I have. That greatness and that failing part of me that's always in battle.
There's a certain strain of entertainer that represent to me the true American spirit. It's the tough guy with a heart. It's James Cagney. It's Billy the Kid.
Whether he struggled, whether he triumphed, whether he had drug addictions or hit records, you know, it was always all of it. And but what to the core of it more than anything was honesty. You know, even in the struggles, you know, he was honest about it. He goes, guess what? Guilty.
Well, I had a song called Folsom Prison Blues that was a hit just before I walked the line. And the people in Texas heard about it at the state prison and got to write me letters asking me to come down there. So we went down, and the reaction I got, it was far and above anything I had ever had in my life. The complete explosion of noise and reaction that they gave me with every song. So we went into Folsom on February 11th, 1968. And recorded the show live.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around a bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on.
The warden at the time, he didn't want to go for it. You know, he didn't let too many outside people come in. But he finally set that up, and the inmates appreciated it. My mama told me,
son. The inmates, when a concert comes out here to put on a show, it's like they escape. You know, even though it's just mentally, they escape from the confines of the prison.
Just the fact he was singing about Folsom Prison made those there, or maybe any other downtrodden person, think, well, here's a guy who understands me a little bit.
Prisons are made out of concrete and steel, so you can hear that. But when I got out of jail when I was 40, I remember sitting in my house going, God, it's so quiet around here. And then when I was asked to do the liner notes for Folsom Prison, I got the record out and I listened to it, and then I realized what that is, what that echo is. It's that metal and that concrete.
Big cigars, well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free.
And I sometimes wondered whether or not his deep identification with prisoners might not have been somehow connected with some of the personal experiences that he had had in fighting addictions and feeling that kind of imprisonment. It's not just a metaphor. There is a sameness to the struggle.
I think Cash was a tolerant human being. I think you become a tolerant human being by being maybe too aware of your own shortcomings.
Well, if they freed me from this prison, if that railroad train was mine.
I think he certainly identified, you know, with the underdog, with the common man being manipulated by the corporate structure or the power structure, whatever it be, because at one level or another, everybody in the South is either a slave or a master.
Folsom intersects with a time and a mood in 1968 that is critical to its success. A lot of artists may have sung about the disenfranchised, but here was Cash performing for them, and I think the market ate it up.
Are we responding to it because of the knowledge that it was recorded in a prison, or is it a more exciting record because of the tension that was created between him and those guys? These guys were genuinely fucking dangerous in certain situations, and I think it's both.
We played prison all over the United States, and it was at his request, because these people, to him, were people. They're God's children, no matter what they had done.
Prison's a prison. That's all it is.
Cash's prison appearances were more than a greeting from the free world. In Cash, prisoners saw a possibility for their own lives on the outside.
I really wasn't a Johnny Cash fan before he came to San Quentin. This guard was paying no attention to him, and he was looking out the door and chewing gum. And Cash looked at him, and the crowd saw him look at him, and Cash imitated that guard like that. Well, he didn't have to sing. He had 5,000 prisoners that loved him immediately because he made fun of the damn screw.
And things in common with you, Mr. Johnny Cash.
Now I taught the weeping willow how to cry, and I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky, and the tears I cried for that woman are gonna flood you, big river, and I'm gonna sit right here until I die.
If you ever read the album cover and the back of it, you would almost believe that Johnny Cash had done hard time.
You don't have to kill nobody to be a gangster. You don't have to beat nobody up. Just the way you carry yourself. You know, you can have a gangster mentality about yourself. You never seen Don Corleone shoot nobody or hurt nobody, but you know he made it happen. So it's just that persona, that spirit of a gangster that he had.
He once told me, he said, Haggard, you're everything that people think I am. He said, people think I've done a lot of time and all this and that. And he said, I did 4 hours, I think he told me, for picking flowers or something. And
yeah.
Folsom Prison and San Quentin were among the biggest albums of his career. Cash's outside gamble had brought him into the center again.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring.
American music is like America in the sense it's not one other country's music. It's like a blend of many countries. And when we blend gospel and mountain and blacks and whites, all this into something, that becomes uniquely American.
When I was a kid, Johnny Cash was really big in England. I just didn't think he was country western music. I thought he was something else. I thought he was like Elvis, like this giant sort of godlike, you know, pop star.
He didn't conform to anything, really, except the world. At the time, having the horns on a hillbilly record was kind of weird, you know? And he thought that I was weird enough to understand it. He called me. Thank the Lord.
And it burns, 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 the ring of fire.
I think someone like Cash was interesting to us because of his willingness to deal with the world head on. And there were a lot of contradictions in what he was doing. He was trying to do good, and then he was kind of naughty as well. Like
ours meet. There's a whole series of contradictions that are at the heart of the American identity, the love of progress and also the love of tradition, for instance. I mean, we're the country that's always looking ahead, always concerned about being the fast lane on the highway of progress. And at the same time, we say we care about family values and about the traditions of the past. And again, Johnny Cash was a person who embodied exactly that kind of contradiction.
The ring of fire, the ring of fire.
When I came to the States, I went on painting Johnny Cash because it felt like he was an image, an icon of a part of America that I had fallen in love with and was fascinated by, which was, you know, wasn't here when I got here. It would, felt like it had been obliterated.
And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire. The ring of fire, the ring of fire.
Johnny Cash was an 18-year-old Air Force trainee stationed down in San Antonio, Texas, when he first met Miss Vivian Liberto. She later became Mrs. Johnny Cash. You might say the music they made together has turned into quite a melody. Now the harmony is provided by Roseanne, Kathy, Cindy, and the latest addition, Little Tara.
I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
There came a time where he was defined by his absence. Dad left and kind of didn't come back for... Even when he did come back, he didn't come back when he was using drugs in that period.
I saw him as something totally different. I mean, I just saw him as my daddy, you know? I mean, I was happy when he was home and sad when he wasn't.
I walked the line.
Cash wrote his most famous song for Vivian while still at Sun, turning personal conflict into poetry.
As sure as night is dark and day is light, I keep you on my mind both day and night. And happiness I've known proves that it's right. Because you're mine, I walk the line.
You know, that's not his natural instinct. I mean, that's what that song says, is that, you know, I wasn't born to walk the line, but I'm going to do it for you.
I was standing by the window on one cold and cloudy day.
Well, there's something about families singing together that is just better than any other groups you can pick up or make, you know. If it's family, if it's blood on blood, then it's gonna be better.
The Carter family probably invented country music pretty much single-handedly. They were the first people that proved that you could make records, singing songs in a style that people had been performing music for themselves on their own front porches for a long time.
Cash had fallen in love with the Carter family long before he fell in love with their daughter, June. When they first met, Johnny swore his intention to wed her, despite the fact that each was presently married.
We got married in a fever.
very much in love with her. He wants to marry her. But she doesn't want to be married to somebody who's so deep in the throes of drug use and self-destruction. It's that hope of pleasing June that begins to mark a change in Cash's personal life.
Honey, I'm gonna snowball Jackson.
See if I can.
The Carters were huge in his salvation. You know, there's probably very few people that have been more influential in anybody's life than June Carter was and Johnny Cash's.
Well, it's a great American, it's a great love story, period. You know? They really were in love.
You turn a loose of my coat, 'cause I'm going to Jackson.
That's all she wrote.
If June hadn't existed, I don't think my dad would have made it. And not for the reasons people think. Not because she saved him from drugs or got him sober or did this, you know. No one person saves another person from themselves. It's not possible. But she did provide the impetus, and she did provide a context for it to happen.
It was interesting both ways, but prior to June Carter, there was a totally different Johnny Cash. She either clipped his wings or saved his life, or both.
Cash could speak from experience that love was hard won and easily lost. It was a lesson he never forgot to preach.
Yeah, I'm going to Jackson.
I've survived a lot, and my greatest achievement would be to be at peace with my family and happy with them and still respect myself.
Johnny Cash. A swinging new way to spend the summer.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
In the turbulent summer of 1969, Americans of all types came together around the TV set to watch the Johnny Cash Show.
Everybody knows where you go when the sun goes down. I think you only live to see the lights of town. I wasted my time when I would try. When the lights lost their glow, you're gonna cry.
The cast of characters that was on that show was kind of life-changing. To have Neil Young and Joni Mitchell and Creedence and Clapton and you name it. It wasn't just his world of country music. He reached out to all things and all people.
I think it's really hard for anybody to even imagine now how important the Johnny Cash Show was, especially to people like me. I mean, the knowledge that Johnny Cash knew who Neil Young was validated me. It made me feel like I wasn't so weird because I listened to both kinds of music.
Get rhythm. When you get the blues, come on, get rhythm. Hey, when you get the blues, a jumpy rhythm makes you feel so fine. Shake all your trouble from your worried mind, get rhythm.
He was a champion of people who had been shunned elsewhere. African-American performers back in the day when network TV was still funny about that, you know?
Johnny Cash was out there on the edge, you know, and even then it was pretty obvious. And of course, it's like Randy Macho Man Savage says, if you're not on the edge, you're taking up too much room.
With what society went through in the 50s and 60s with civil rights and with Vietnam and and kind of this great awakening of our country in a sense, and a great change in our country. I don't think you'll probably ever see our country go through something like that again.
One morning at breakfast, I said to my wife, we've been everywhere once and some places twice. As I had another helping of country ham, she said, we ain't never been to Vietnam. And there's a bunch of our boys over there. So we went to the Orient, Saigon.
Well, Cash had always been an individual who had no truck with the federal government. He respected leadership. After all, FDR had helped bail his family out of Depression misery. But as the war rages on, as more men come home in body bags, he begins to question that authority.
When somebody tells you something and they're the commander-in-chief and they're telling the people that's doing the fighting what to do and the reason why they're doing it, and it all turns out to be less than fact, well, it's scary.
I think he instinctively knew that all of that was wrong and that the people that it was happening to were people like the people that he knew when he was growing up.
She said, I'm scared. I said, me too.
There are times when I've become unmarketable for different political things that I've stood for. But John never was. I think because people believed him. Because of his integrity.
Well, you know, if you're on television every week like I was back in the early 70s, and you speak out on these things, then you'll get it thrown back in your face, regardless of what your stand is. But if you know what you want, the tide of popular opinion won't wash you away if you're not a rivulet, if you're a stream.
We were also invited to do a concert for President Nixon. John didn't go there to support him, because he didn't support none of them. He just gave his views mostly in song.
Nixon requested Cash play Welfare Cadillac, Guy Drake's song about poor people cheating the system. When Cash refused, it caused a stir.
We'd like to set the record straight about the song Welfare Cadillac, which we understand the president requested that you perform tonight, and you didn't.
There was a request came down for three songs, for me to do three songs. A Boy Named Sue, Okie from Muskogee, and Welfare Cadillac. And when the request came down, I said, fine, okay, whatever he'd like to hear. But then I heard Welfare Cadillac.
Well, what a dumb request, anyway. Welfare Cadillac had nothing to do with John, but I'm sure that was the right-winger's request.
It's rather hard to describe Johnny Cash in terms that are perhaps adequate, except for those who know his music. I'm not an expert on his music. Incidentally, I found that out when I began to tell him what to sing.
The closest Cash came to a song with obvious political overtones was his latest hit, which, unusual for him, has a theme not from the 30s, but from now. And the thrust of it seemed to surprise the president a bit.
Young man sitting on the witness stand, man with a book says, raise your hand, repeat after me, I solemnly swear. Judge looked down at his long hair, and although the young man solemnly swore, nobody seemed to hear anymore. And it didn't really matter if the truth was there. It was the cut of his clothes and the length of his hair. And the lonely voice of youth cries, what is truth? Young girl dancing to the latest beat, found new ways to move her feet. A young man speaking in a city square might be trying to say that he really cares.
I do know that he was born in Arkansas, and he now lives in Tennessee. But he belongs to the whole country.
We better help that voice of youth find what is truth. And the lonely voice of youth cries, what is truth?
You guys have to get up awfully early, don't you?
As Watergate divided the country, Cash attended
I've never seen a Johnny Cash show on which Johnny Cash did not include a hymn. Tonight is no exception. Johnny is joined by Jan Howard, June Carter, and Mama Maybelle Carter for the very beautiful Were You There When They Crucified My Lord.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
Sometimes it causes me to tremble.
Tremble.
What is man if he doesn't have a spirit? And what is man's spirit if it cannot connect with the master of life? That is the big question, I guess. That is the big thing I would like to work on more.
Johnny Cash had been battling with the master of life for most of his own life. His dark side never did subside, and every breath was a conflict between good intent and bad desires.
Sometimes it causes me to tremble.
Tremble.
In late 1967, it seemed like the dark side had won. Cash crawled into the Nickajack Cave in Chattanooga with a pocket full of pills, determined never to come out. Instead, he heard a different voice.
There was a time for me that I discovered that Jesus would be the way out for me. Not just the way, but the way out. Because I had kind of imposed a death sentence upon myself for the kind of life that I was living. And I saw that the only way out, after I'd tried everything, would be to go back to Jesus.
Four o'clock in the morning comes for everybody. After you quit reaching for the pill bottle, maybe that's where Billy Graham came in.
Tonight, I do not need to introduce our special guest because he's known all over America and all over the world. All you have to do is talk about the man in black. And I'm proud and honored and thrilled to present tonight my very good and warm friend in Christ, Johnny Cash.
Shortly after rededicating himself to Christ, Cash met Billy Graham, pastor to the presidents. Over the decades, Cash performed at dozens of Graham's massive crusades.
Billy had respect for everything that John ever did, and he knew his drug problem. But he also knew there was a great man under this shell.
You know, you've been such a great blessing to so many millions of people. I just want to say, God bless you, Billy Graham.
Well, God bless you, and a Merry Christmas.
Thank you. John Carter, come here, son.
He asked every day, his God, please. A person who died between two criminals, and so on. And so if those are indeed contradictions, there are contradictions that Christianity would affirm as being at the very heart of the Christian story.
God is a loving God. He don't mind what you do. He know what you do. He planned it to be like that. So you can't, you know, say you hypocritical because you make a song about beers, girls, and killing, then you make a song about loving God and living. I mean, that's just your heart and your spirit on that day saying that you are forgiving for the things that you will do.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, when the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on that other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Through the 70s was the greatest years of all of our lives. We were just so close.
Cash relapsed in the late 1970s. Though his battles with addiction continued, he never lost his faith.
I don't think that he believed that having faith had anything to do with being good.
Let us lay before the master from the dawn till setting sun.
There was no secret that he was addicted to drugs and struggled and struggled and struggled and had the demons that he had. But people seemed to embrace and love the entirety of who he was and not just kind of cherry pick the best parts of him.
One of the responsibilities of a member of the human race is to take the next step intellectually, take the next step spiritually, to not put limitations on yourself. These are my shortcomings, but I don't have to stay this way, you know, and that's inspiring.
When the road is called up yonder, I'll be there. I walked through a county courthouse square. On a park bench, an old man was sitting there. I said, "Your old courthouse is kind of run down." He said, "No, it'll do for our little town." I said, "Your old flagpole has leaned a little bit, and that's a ragged old flag you got hanging on it."
What a pleasure it is to be here today to take part in this celebration honoring the 200th anniversary of our great flag.
Johnny Cash was proud of the opportunities America afforded people with little means. He cared not for party affiliation, but for right and wrong.
I don't like to brag, but we're kind of proud of that ragged old flag. You see, we got a little hole in that flag there when Washington took it across the Delaware. And it got powder burned the night Francis Scott Key set up watching it writing, "Say, can you see?"
He was intensely patriotic and not at all abashed about expressing it in a very emotional way that some super sophisticated audience might think was corny. I never thought it was at all.
He studied the history of our nation. This was the nature of who he was. He had a great love for history, period. He recorded the Gettysburg Address, and when he did so, he wrote it out by hand.
So we raise her up every morning, and we bring her down slowly every night. We don't let her touch the ground, and we fold her upright.
He loved to study about the wars, about presidents, about the American Indians.
On second thought, I guess I do like to brag, because I'm mighty proud of that ragged old flag.
I'm a flag-waving patriotic, nephew of my Uncle Sam, a rough-riding, fighting Yankee man.
Johnny said a lot of things about America. I think the primary thing he said was, "I am a country boy from Arkansas, able to do the things that I'm doing, primarily because I am an American."
You know, the great American dreams are still worth working for. May your dreams come true, but make sure that you've got your dreams saddled before you try to ride it. Good night, and God bless you, America.
He was as good a world ambassador as we could devise or define. Obviously, the State Department could use somebody like that, I think, right now.
John had the kind of patriotism where he always felt it was his duty to serve his country. And he continued to be serving his country as an artist by the things that he was saying.
He was fearless in adopting positions that might be to the right of the country, to the left of the country. It didn't matter. He followed what he thought was right on many issues.
I don't believe in violence. I'm a God-fearing man. But I'd stand up for my country just as long as I could stand.
In the 70s, when Johnny Cash was rising to the peak of his prominence, Republicans and Democrats both believed in a certain degree of taking care of those who were falling through the cracks in society. It was a very different time, and there was more of an overall consensus that we are all Americans.
And I enjoy the liberty of being what I want to be.
Cash's unabashed patriotism made him ever more revered. he became increasingly known as the nation's patriot rather than as a working artist.
Music appeals to people's emotional side, not their logic. So if you can play a song that emotionally might creep into someone's heart or his brain for a moment, then you've really succeeded as a politician.
All presidents wanted to be with Johnny Cash. He was always invited to the White House for this, for that, for something else.
When he went in that room, you could hear a pin drop. It was like they could feel him. Every person in that room was just almost petrified, not at the president, but for the one and only John R. Cash.
But when a new day dawned in America, Cash found himself disappearing in the spotlight.
It's morning again in America. America today is prouder and stronger and better. Why would we want to return to where we were less than four short years ago?
Hello there.
Mr. President, well, very nice to see you again.
Nice to see you,
Johnny Cash.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you.
As we got to the end of the 70s and into the 80s in the Reagan era, Johnny Cash is more of a fish out of water than he's ever been in his whole life.
Thanks for your time, Mr.
Well, thank you very much.
Good to see you.
God bless you.
In the midst of some of these English bands from the 80s, it was hard to have a connection with John Cash when you had hair like this, you know.
During the 1980s, Johnny Cash fell victim to the corporate bottom line.
The notion that Columbia Records would terminate his contract, to me, was evidence of insanity. Because when I was a janitor at Columbia, Johnny Cash was the reason they existed.
He couldn't believe how they, you know, he took him up into the building that he'd paid for and then threw him out in the dumpster, you know.
And I think that happens because Cash's profit margins weren't what the company thought they should be. I think that really symbolizes the advent of corporate dominance in our nation, a dominance that often left the little guy on the side of the road.
This town will destroy what it can't control. And I know that sounds paranoid, but it's done it over and over and over again. This is not a singer-songwriter town.
Yeah, I got one more, don't I? Yeah. Comes and goes.
In 1985, Cash formed the Highwaymen with Waylon Jennings, Chris Christopherson, and Willie Nelson. With his old friends, Cash again stood tall in the spotlight.
I've been up and down and out, and I have been around. And I felt good more times than I felt bad.
He loved the Highwaymen. He loved doing that because he loved every one of those guys in that band. He loved them all individually for different reasons, you know.
Willie's the outlaw coyote. Waylon's a riverboat gambler. I'm the revolutionary communist radical. And John is the father of our country. And the day my highs didn't get any lower and my lows didn't drop anymore. But sometimes when I drop my guard, everybody knows I can't control the feeling.
I thank God for all the freedoms we've got in this country. I cherish them. Even the rights to burn the flag, you know. I'm proud of those rights. But I tell you what, we've also got, let me tell you something. We've also got a right to bear arms, and if you burn my flag, I'll shoot you.
My son Johnny, who was about 4 or 5 at the time, said to John when we were backstage, he said, I'm gonna shoot you. And it was a line that always got him a tremendous amount of applause, a big audience reaction. And he looked at my son and he said, I'm never gonna sing that again. And he never did.
I can't control the feeling, and there ain't much sign of healing. Cause when the pain is there, it always shows. But it comes and goes.
When in 1991, when we went to the first Gulf War, my father sent a letter to George Bush Sr. and said, I'm scared that this is not the right thing to do.
I have a letter that Bush wrote back to him explaining why it was necessary. It just really frightened Dad. I think he'd be more frightened now, though.
The fact is, he was a patriot, and being against the war was maybe more patriotic than being for it.
Our country's sort of up for grabs right now. You know, it's being sold off. Somebody said they ought to go ahead and sell Yankee Stadium and give the White House away and get it over with.
But it comes and goes.
By the 90s, Cash, like many of his generation, saw his opportunities wane and faced playing out the sunset of his career to diminishing returns.
I was with him in Indianapolis one night, and he said, you know, you saw the crowd tonight. I mean, it wasn't that big. They were enthusiastic, and he wasn't complaining, but he was just saying that, you know, he needed money. And he said, you know, I'm gonna have to go to Branson.
In 1993, Cash booked into Branson, Missouri, with 2 months of 6 shows a week.
But he didn't enjoy doing a show every night. He felt boxed in. He couldn't go wherever he wanted in the world to sing his songs, and I think didn't want to be forgotten.
I was there the day when he told the audience, he said, I love every one of y'all. And he says, I'm going to give you the best show I can, but he says, I will not be back to Branson. He said goodbye that day to the audience that was out there, and there was probably less than 100 people.
And I felt the same thing in the last 10 years of my career, you know. Felt largely ignored by radio and all those kinds of things. And every artist, regardless of who it is, goes through it, you know, even Johnny Cash.
Again, one person can't save another person, but almost. Almost.
Most of the artists that I had worked with at that time were all new bands and young artists, and I was thinking it'd be really fun to work with a substantial grown-up artist. And Johnny was the first one to came into my mind of really legendary status, important, timeless artist.
So I said, well, have Rick come down and see us. We'll be in Santa Ana doing a concert at Supper Club. And they just sat and stared at each other for about 2 minutes, I guess sizing each other up, and then they began to chat and just got on. It was just magic.
But the kind of theme of the album is sin and redemption, and thank God for redemption, or I wouldn't be here, which is the title of the last song I wrote for the album. From his hands it came down, from his side it came down, from his feet it came down and ran to the ground. Between heaven and hell, a teardrop fell in the deep crimson dew. The tree of life grew.
Rick focused on stuff that was darker. The young people in black, these goth kids with piercings and tattoos, said, hey, you know, this is great. I love it.
The fire and the flood clung to the tree and were redeemed by the blood.
It feels so good with those young people and the adulation. I just love it. I've always been a big ham. I just eat it up. And the ones who've been into my new recordings are becoming familiar with some of the old stuff, like Folsom and I Walk the Line and Ring of Fire. And those songs now just really get a reaction like I did on my songs back in the 50s.
Rick Rubin knew that pairing Cash with new music, with new artists, would help bring him to a new audience. He knew that by darkening Cash's image, this after 20 years of Cash presenting himself as the patriot and the Christian, that new audiences who were interested in the dark side would come to Cash again.
He saw light again. You know, it's like, hey, you know, I can still relate to young people, you know, and And he had pretty much given that up.
From his hands it came down, from his side it came down, from his feet it came down and ran to the ground.
If you go into a punk rock fan, their house in Frankfurt, Germany, and you look up on their shelves, you'll see the Sex Pistols, you know, you'll see the Misfits, and you'll see Johnny Cash. If you go to a little old lady's house in Schenectady who loves country music and gospel songs, you look up on her record shelves and there's just as many Johnny Cash records.
Through the fire and the flood, I clung to the tree and was redeemed by the blood.
In 1998, Cash and Rubin used an iconic image to thank the country establishment for their role in his newfound success.
I think Johnny Cash was the embodiment of punk. You know, this is a guy who was like a total rebel. And, you know, that picture of him flipping off the camera is, to me, the summation of rock and roll.
John said something to me once. He said, I can't remember what he said. I just wanted to make sure that they knew that I still had my stinger out.
As Cash's popularity regained strength, his body weakened. He took refuge in a cabin studio behind his home.
He had chronic pain in his jaw the last 15 years of his life. He lived with that physical pain, but at the same time, it was one of the greatest creative periods of his life. It was the, you know, a period of hardship, and that was something that he did express through his music.
He was consciously dealing with mortality. You know, it's the view into this giant that's dying in front of the microphone.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel.
He said, you gotta see my new video. I said, okay, great. I'm sitting in the floor with my husband and we're watching this video, and I'm just like crying because it's very sad for me. And when it was over, he said, what do you think? You know, he's so proud of it. And I said, I thought it was disturbing. And he said, disturbing? You know, he was shocked that I had said that. And I said, well, Dad, I mean, it kind of sounds like you're saying goodbye. And he goes, well, I am.
Everyone I know goes away in the end, and you could have it all, my empire of dirt.
But when I realized what he was saying in that song, Rick Rubin was a miracle worker with Johnny and produced something that said what his life was all about. You can have your mountain of dirt, as he calls it, your castles in the sand. But he said, bottom line is, do it right.
I am still right here. What have I become? My sweetest friend.
He told me he wanted to work every single day and that I had to find something for him to do every day, because he said if he didn't work, he would die.
He never ever feared the end. I think sometimes he actually looked forward to it. Be no more pain. You know, and he knew where he was going.
I will let you down. I will make you hurt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I would keep myself, I would find a way.
are at our best as a country. We transcend the ideological and partisan lines that people try to impose on the country. And Johnny really did exemplify that kind of American spirit.
He was able to take ideas and conversations and input from people who weren't from his world, and that's what made his world so broad to where it appealed to numerous amounts of people.
We are missing Johnny Cash, and I'm longing for a Johnny Cash. I'm longing for someone to step up and write some of these songs that will lead us emotionally in a protest, and that will lead us in a patriotic questioning of what's going on here and how did this happen.
We have to be as open-minded and honest as John was. I don't think I've met another person that's that open-minded.
Well, I don't think anybody's going to ever completely understand Johnny Cash and his influence in the world. It was just magic, that's all. The guy was just, maybe he's a saint.
Come along and ride this train. Come along and ride this train. Across the mountains, prairies, reservations, rivers, levees, plains. Come along and ride this train. I know a land where mountain streams are running free. I know a prairie where there's miles between each tree. I know where there's people you would like to get to know. Come along with me and go. Come along and ride this train. Come along and ride this train. Across the mountains, prairies, reservations, rivers, levees, plains. Come along and ride this train. I heard a story that I'd like to share with you. I know a valley that I'd like to take you through. I will show you things that I am sure you'd like to see. Come along and go with me. Come along and ride this train. Come along and ride this train. Across the mountains, prairies, reservations, rivers, levees, plains. Come along and ride this train.